Today, we are standing at the cusp of revolution in biomedical research. A few months ago, on March 24th, 2016, Dr. Craig Venter, a biotechnologist, announced from the sunny beaches of California the creation of artificial bacteria with a very tiny genome. We have created an organism whose parent is a computer. This was done by first creating the genetic code of the organism in a computer, synthesizing the genes from four bottles of chemicals, assembling those genes in yeast to make the complete code, and then transplanting those in a bacterial cell, creating a new bacterial species. In some sense, this means that humans have created life, life as we know it, and it can have huge implications in every area that we can think of. Such technological advancements can bring us relief from incurable diseases, but as some scientists argue, it might put the very survival of our species at stake. And in this film, we will try to look briefly at the history of this science that has come to be known as genetics, technical breakthroughs which has made this work possible, and also try to explore and understand the issues related to this announcement. Even in prehistoric times, humans realized that they transmitted likeness or similarity to their children, children to their grandchildren, and so on. But exactly how that happened was not clear. And Aristotle, around 350 BC, suggested that this likeness was carried in the blood by men and women. No wonder humans spilled so much blood over lineage. In the next 2000 years, little progress was made in this domain until Charles Darwin, in 1859, in his seminal work on the origin of species by means of natural selection, suggested passing of this likeness to subsequent generations subject to selection pressures. While this might sound a mouthful, what he basically meant was that traits which help the survival of species in the long term get selected naturally to be passed on to the future generations. 24 years later, in 1883, a German biologist, August Weismann, conducted an interesting experiment to examine the means of passing this likeness or traits. He cut off the tails of male and female mice to see the effect on the offspring. What do you think happened? Well, no tailless mice were born. All mice had tails. And what this experiment showed was that information of a trait is not stored just in any specific part of the body, but in some basic units in the body. But the exact science and location and transmission mechanism was still unknown, and understanding this was the missing science. Not surprisingly, the invisible man H.G. Wells had remarked that this science, now called genetics, which we knew very little about then, would be 10 times more important to humanity than all the chemistry and physics and technical and industrial science that ever had been or ever would get discovered. And in 1863 happened the most important experiment in the history of genetics. And interestingly, this would not have happened had Gregor Mendel listened to his father and taken over the family business. Instead, Mendel chose to study further and joined a monastery in Brno. His heart lay in science, and at that time, since he was forbidden to experiment with mice in the monastery, he started growing peas and making hybrids, crossing tall plants with short plants, white flowers with purple flowers, smooth pods with crumpled pods. He observed 7 different traits of peas and observed the patterns, ratios in subsequent generation of peas, thereby tapping into the inner logic of genetics. For instance, he found that breeding yellow pea and a green pea plant always resulted in yellow peas in the first generation of pea plant. However, in the second generation of the plant, the offspring were not only yellow, but a mix of green and yellow in the ratio of 1:3. Now, this could only have happened if both yellow and green traits were present in all the plants of the first generation, but only yellow showed up being dominant. However, in the second generation, 1/4 of the plant got the recessive green trait from both the parents, thereby producing green peas. He saw similar behavior for the other 6 traits also. This and other such incredible experiments uncovered the idea of discrete particles of inheritance. And after 8 years of research, in 1865, Mendel published his findings to a room full of farmers and botanists in Proceedings of Brno Natural Science Society. Mendel had discovered the basic unit of heredity. And finally, a Dutch botanist, Wilhelm Johansson, in the beginning of 20th century, named this unit the gene. Griffiths in 1928 and Avery McLeod McCarty experiment done in 1944 were the final nails in the genetic coffin. Aha! They infected a mice with harmless bacteria and partial cell extract of dead pneumonia-causing bacteria. Using some high chemistry extraction techniques, discovered this cell extract as DNA or deoxyribonucleic acid. Not long after, Rosalind Franklin, Watson and Crick in 1953 discovered the physical structure of the gene, the famous double helix, the winding base pairs of DNA where genes are strung along chromosomes like beads on strings. Ironically, all these guys got the Nobel except the father of genetics, Mendel, because Mendel died in 1883 when Alfred Nobel, the founder of Nobel Prize, was ironically making money off dynamite and explosives to support the Nobel Prize. So what exactly is this gene? Not to be confused with genes with a J, which was, by the way, also invented around the same time. Gene is a message, a code, storing all information about our form, shape, being, and is made by 4 different types of units called the bases. These are the same 4 chemicals using which Dr. Venter created artificial life. These bases pair with specific bases. A binds only with T and C binds only with G. Paired bases form a sort of helical ladder binding the 2 strands of DNA. Interestingly, this is the same ladder that Watson, Crick and Wilkins climbed Nobel Prize glory, and Rosalind Franklin, the lady who took the first picture of double helix, the acclaimed photo 51, fell off that ladder metaphorically. Each gene has roughly 1,000 base pairs arranged in a linear sequence of letters A, T, C, G. And it is mind-boggling to imagine that these carriers of traits are present in every single of our 10 trillion cells. And total weight of these bases in a human body is about 10 to 60 grams. Genes encode the making of proteins. Now, these proteins in turn control and regulate all the bodily function that happen in each of our cells. And ironically, proteins also regulate their own creator, the genes themselves. As carriers of traits, genes might or might not be expressed, and consequently traits might or might not show up in the organism. Just like Mendel's peas in the first generation had the gene for green color, but yellow dominated and masked the green. This can happen due to various reasons, some of which we know and some we don't. And our environment can also affect the expression of these genes. These are intricate mechanisms, and scientists are working hard to understand those. For instance, eye color, hair color, some diseases like sickle cell anemia, etc., are heritable. And there are some others whose inheritance we know very little about, such as intelligence and emotions, etc. In the last few decades, we have made even bigger technological advances. We have decoded the complete genetic code of humans of 6 billion base pairs, counted all the genes, about 22,000, and learned to remove, cut and paste these genes, and most importantly, proved that all human beings are 99.99% exactly same genetically, regardless of color, caste, creed, religion, sex. We have also found out that an onion, frog, wheat and amoebae have more genes than we humans do. So much for human superiority. We have deciphered our big genetic book consisting of 6 billion letters. Surprisingly, only 4 letters, but 97% of the book is filled with repeats or is seemed to be empty. Genes make up only 3% of this genetic book. And this is where the challenge of this century lies, to figure out what the rest of the book or 97% of the genetic code does for us. While a gene tells some of what we are, it is also abundantly clear that we are not just a sum total of our genes. It is paradoxical and we need to accept and understand it. We will need to tread carefully as we try to understand the role of genes and not succumb to baseless theories such as relating intelligence to the skin color. Hence, we need to transcend our genome in this era where we can write ourselves. Thank you for watching.